What's happening, pal?
How are you, buddy? Very happy to be here today.
Everything is all right. I enjoyed this episode. You're doing all right out there? Everything's good?
This is a great, great, one of the best episodes, really. It was a lot of fun and very disturbing to watch.
Yeah. It's good stuff. Good stuff. You know, it's funny. This episode, you know, I became a series regular in season three. So I moved my family and me, HBO moved us back to New York from Las Vegas. You know, first year I had commuted and I wasn't working much. You know, I mean, I was in the second one a little, the third one a little. I wasn't in one. I wasn't in four. So it was kind of weird to me, you know, to be honest.
Season three.
I was saying to myself, you know.
After you moved.
Yeah. I'm saying, you know what? What the hell did I move here for? You know?
Sure.
You know, I mean, I could have commuted. I mean, I'm not working. I was kind of frustrated, to be honest with you. There was, you know, I had a couple lines in each episode. I'll be honest, I was extremely frustrated. It was couple of months, I really didn't do a whole lot. You know, I rented a house in Staten Island, and then finally this episode came up, and you know, it's the first time I got a chance to do something. You know, they gave me a father.
So you moved the kids? Kids moved to Staten. You put them in different school and all that stuff. Yeah,
well,
that's you went all in.
My wife homeschooled my older daughter. My other one wasn't ready for school yet. We rented a house. I wasn't that familiar, so I rented a house in Staten Island to be close to my friends. And I shipped my car out. Yeah, we went all in, man. And then I wasn't working, and I'm going, what the fuck? You know?
Yeah.
And then this came up, and then, you know, and later on you've got the Pine Barrens and other good stuff. But at this point, I was getting extremely frustrated. You know, I was like, fuck. They made me a series regular not to use me, you know?
Well, and you don't know. You don't know. Is it going to get bigger? Is it going to stay the same? Is it going to, you know, are they going to kill you off? Who knows? You never know. It's very uncertain.
Absolutely. All of the above. You know, that's why as soon as I started making some money, I paid my house off. I figured if all else goes bad, I'll just move back to Vegas and at least I have somewhere to live, right?
But then you moved to Manhattan. You didn't stay in Staten Island.
No, I just stayed there 6 months. All due respect for the people of Staten Island, and I know plenty of them, and they're wonderful people. My wife is not from New York City. And if you're not from New York City and you try to put somebody in Staten Island, it's like they landed on Mars, man. You know, it's just a whole another world. I mean, for me, it was fine, but it was like my wife would go to the store. She saw shit she never thought existed, you know. So, yeah, it's, you know, a one-of-a-kind place in the entire world. And I'm not saying bad. It's just very different Staten Island, you know.
Yeah.
You have
a lot of good food on Staten Island.
Fantastic food. It's Staten Island is what Brooklyn was in the 60s, 70s, 80s. That's Staten Island now. All those people, the next generation, they sold their, you know, families,
a lot of people
houses.
From Brooklyn. Yeah, a lot.
A lot of cops, a lot of firemen.
Dr. Bill Bongiorno lives on Staten Island, one of my best friends in the world,
And they've
he's taking me to some good restaurants.
Great restaurants. I mean, they got nice houses. I mean, it's great. It's just that if you're from somewhere else, it's certainly different.
Well, and it's not easy getting in and out. You either take the ferry, you got to take the bridge. It could be traffic. It's hard commuting from there.
You know, you got to go over that Guinea gangplank. You know, the Verrazano Bridge.
Working at Silver Cup of Jersey, that's a rough commute.
Well, one I drove, and then when I didn't drive, I took the ferry. Take a cab to the ferry, downtown. Then you got to take the N train to Long Island City. It's a long commute. It took me a long time, you know. At one point, they weren't picking me up. It was like, you know, shaky. So, you know, you got to put your time in, but that's the way it goes, right? You know.
So that's why you're wearing the Teamster shirt. So
Teamsters,
forever they'll be picking you up.
They'll pick me up.
Now you want them. You're going to wear that, and they advertise for the Teamsters.
I'm kissing a little Teamster ass so I could get my rights. Back and forth. I'm kissing Teamster's ass. It's okay. I don't have a problem with that. You know, during this, you know, we've talked a lot about movies and music and stuff. I've been reading a shit ton. Yeah, and I've always been a big reader.
Me too. Me too.
Since all this started. And but I read, I don't know, we probably don't read the same stuff. I could almost bet on it. We've never talked about this in the 20 so years I know you. I'm a nonfiction guy. I'm a sports, showbiz, bands, nonfiction, bios.
History? You like history?
Nah, not really. That's really like kind
more current, of current stuff.
It's kind biography. Of a one note, to be honest. Yeah, you know, memoirs. Yeah. You know,
I'm more fiction. I like fiction, and I read a lot of like Buddhism stuff. But I'm a snob when it comes to.
You're a snob, period. Not to me, but you're a snob.
No, all right, I'm not.
Folks, he admitted
when it. Comes
it.
To books, I'm
Michael Imperioli is a snob.
A, without a doubt, a book snob. I have no. It has to be. You know,
really
of a certain quality. Oh yeah, without a doubt.
You see,
I'm not. You know, I'm not a TV star. I mean, I watch. You know, I watch like last night. I watched Taxi reruns and American Dad. Like, I'm not a snob when it comes to that stuff. Books, I'm a snob. Because books are a big investment of time. Some books are really long. They might take you a couple of weeks. It's a big investment. I don't read books just to pass time. Or, you know, because I do it to be. I want to be in the presence of someone who really knows how to handle the language and do something interesting with it. I don't want to just like be entertained by some formulaic plot or something like that. I'm a lit snob, without a doubt.
You know, I don't. I'm not a fiction guy at all. Like I said, I read people I'm interested in. I'm interested in a lot of people's their journey, like how they got to where they got. And you know what? If I don't like it, you know, if I'm a chapter in or something, you know, I go to the. I like to go to the bookstore. I'm still, you know,
me
I don't
too.
Like. To, I don't like to order on Amazon.
It.
You know.
Me too. When I travel, one of the first things I do, like when I go on location, is find the bookstores. Like in Vancouver, there's a place called the Paper Hound. That's an amazing bookstore. In New York, you got Left Bank Books. You got McNally Jackson, Three Lives. L.A. You have Book Soup.
Yeah,
that's a really great bookstore. San Francisco, you got City Lights, one of the best in the world, one of my favorites.
You know, I'll go. You know,
Portland. Have you been to Powell's in Portland? It's the, one of the biggest in the whole world.
I've never even been to Portland.
It's like a whole city block. It's kind of like the Strand, which is another one of my favorite bookstores. That's in New York, but the Powell's is like a whole block bigger than the Strand. It's gigantic.
Really?
It's immense. Yeah, it's great. Really great.
You know, but I'll
independent
you know,
bookstores, important.
There's a lot service. Less of them. There's a lot. There's one, a really good one in Long Island that I've done some book signings. I can't think of it in Huntington. Maybe Andy could give us the name of that. I don't know. There's some really, really good ones left. There's not. It's hard to be an independent bookstore. I mean, these fucking corporate giants came in. They lowered the price. How could they compete, you know?
Yeah, but, you know, ironically, a lot of the big bookstores, the chains like Barnes & Noble, a lot of those have gone down. And there was that other big, what was that other? Borders went out of business.
Borders.
And ironically, the little bookstores have found a niche because book lovers like myself and you want to go to these small places. We want to go to the little bookstores, you know.
Well, I certainly like to support them. You know, the Borders, the CEO of Borders, I believe it was the CEO or the president, he used to once be in the supermarket. It's called Book Review in Long Island, Huntington. Great, great independent bookstore. It's called the Book Review. But, you know, Borders used to, the CEO of Borders used to be the CEO of like a huge supermarket chain. And they had that same mentality. You had to pay to get your book on the table, which I've talked about before. You got to take, you know, you go down the aisle, that book is turned. It's got you. They pay for that. You know, Barnes & Noble, pick of the week, employee picks. You pay for that.
Sure.
You know, it's not just the best book. You know, I wonder, and I don't know if anyone's ever done this, if they just took a book and they knew it was a piece of shit and they just said, we're going to market it and market it and market it. I wonder if it could become a bestseller just from the bullshit, you know?
Sure. Sure, you know what they I mean? Do that with movies all the time.
Yeah.
You know, TV
shows. They cut the trailer. But, you know, so I like showbiz memoirs if I'm interested. Like, you know, I mean, I just read Sidney Lumet's book, which is great. I'm a big Sidney Lumet fan.
Which one? Because he wrote a good book on directing.
He didn't write it. This was a biography.
Yeah.
This is a biography of him. You know, Michael Caine has two great books, Blowing the Bloody Doors Off and Michael Caine on Acting. When I started, somebody recommended it to me. And Michael Caine's book, and there was also a tape with it, a CD, he simplifies acting to me. You know, I tried to read David Mamet's book and this guy and that guy. It may as well have been in a different fucking language for me. I didn't even know what they were talking about. Michael Caine, if you want to be an actor or just very entertaining, and both of his books talk about the business, and he's just a colorful guy. I enjoy that. I just read
Charles Grodin wrote a book called It Would Be So Nice If You Weren't Here, because that's how he always felt when he would go on auditions. Like that's what he felt like they thought of him when he, because actors are so insecure after being rejected so much that he always feeling comfortable, like they don't want you there. It would be so nice if you weren't here, was what he was always projecting that onto the people.
And you read the book? Is it good?
Long time ago, yeah. It's very funny. Charles Grodin was very, very funny.
Oh, yeah. I love him. I'm going to get that. That's something I was not aware of that at all.
Just read this. This is called Inferno. This is Eileen Miles.
Uh-huh.
The great Eileen Miles. This is called a poet's novel, but it's in the form of a memoir. I think it is partly memoir about, she's a poet and a novelist in New York, and it's really about her life, and it's just written really well and beautifully, and she's pretty fantastic. And this book, this is Set the Controls for the Heart of Sharon Tate, which is written by my friend Gary Lipman, and it's a really great book about this really strange, obsessed fan club of Sharon Tate's. And it's about kind of celebrity obsession and the lengths people go with their obsessions in celebrity. It's a really great novel. I enjoyed that.
And it's a novel based on true things, I would assume.
A little bit. No, it's fiction. It's not set at the time of Sharon Tate. It's really about people who were obsessed with her. But it's fiction. It's really good. And really fun and disturbing and twisted. It's kind of like in the vein of like Terry Southern, that type of social satire a little bit, you know?
A great book, Neil Simon, memoirs. It's like three of his memoirs together. Mm. Terrific. Martin Short, great, great. I'm a very big Martin Short fan. I think he's one of the funniest guys. He writes about his wife, they were married for many, many years. And if you don't cry, you don't have a heart. Because I got to tell you, the way he describes her is just really heart-wrenching. And it's a great memoir. I read recently Woody Allen's book, Apropos of Nothing. Whether you like Woody Allen or not, it's a really good book, man. And he explains a lot, you know? He explains a lot in there. A lot of things that I didn't know. And you know, I worked with him, and I also have been a longtime fan. And, you know, he answers a lot of questions that people would be surprised, you know. I mean, don't get me wrong. I still find it very strange that of all the women in the world, he had to marry his wife's stepdaughter. I find that odd.
Yeah. That'll cause a rift within the family.
Yeah, but I mean, I find it very odd. I mean, I absolutely.
Of course it's odd.
Of all the fucking women, I mean, you know, those are some things you just shut off. And, you know, it's like a guy, you got divorced, say, well, I'm really attracted to my good buddy's ex-wife. You just don't go there, man. You just don't go there. You know what I mean? You know, so
yeah, no,
he went in a place where I didn't think he should. Of course, our friend, I did read one novel, Dennis Hamill, The Ten Spot. Our friend Dennis Hamill, who writes for Law and Order. That's a novel, a detective novel, a private eye. And I think Dennis is one of the best writers, and he's writing for Law and Order.
You should read Me and the Devil by Nick Tosches, which is someone I knew, a great one of my favorite writers. He passed away last October. But Me and the Devil is all set in Tribeca, around where we used to live, and it's kind of a vampire story. It's tremendous,
and it's a novel.
Really good book. But he writes as if it's himself. So because Nick lived in Tribeca. And he's portraying himself in the book. He has dinner with Keith Richards at Minetta Tavern because Keith was a friend of his. And it's as if he's playing himself in the book and he becomes a vampire. Really? It's so good and very dark and twisted. But, you know, we saw him at Walker's one night.
Remember? We saw him. He was fucking Nick hammered. I thought we were drunk. He was way drunker than us.
He was hammered, but he was very lucid for somebody. He was a special guy. The Dakota Winters. This is a great book by Tom Barabash, which it's set in the building, the Dakota, in the 70s.
Where John Lennon lives.
And John Lennon's in the book as a character. And then there's this other guy, Buddy Winter, who's a talk show host, kind of a Mike Douglas, Merv Griffin type of character. Dick Cavett, kind of that kind of character, and his younger son who kind of becomes a friend of the Lennons. Really good book. Tom Barabash, really good.
I just read Alex Trebek's book, Jeopardy. See, we have complete different. We couldn't be more different on the book scale, that's for sure. But Alex Trebek, who's got stage 4 pancreatic cancer, who I did Jeopardy. I met him. I thought he was a good guy. It's a fascinating story where he came from.
He's a horse guy, right? Didn't he own thoroughbreds?
Horse guy and a good guy, and I enjoyed that a lot. I'm reading a book that you would probably like, Leonard Cohen's.
Leonard Cohen. You know, Leonard Cohen became a monk. Do they go into that? You know, he became a Zen Buddhist monk for several years. He was living in a monastery during the 80s.
And his business manager robbed all his money while he was away. While he was there.
Gotta watch your money.
A lot of books of poetry. I'm just about 100 pages in, so I haven't gotten to a lot of that yet. But I'm a fan there. I a baseball guy, Jim Bouton, who wrote Ball 4. That's a really good fucking book, you know. I mean, I like when I'm entertained. Sandy Koufax book.
Hey, Whitey Ford passed away.
Yeah. Whitey Ford passed away, and I remember.
Didn't Whitey Ford have a beef with Johnny V? Didn't they get it? They went at it, right?
They had a beef on the golf course. It was a charity golf course. Johnny was really embarrassed because he had come to me. You know, I've been embarrassed a million fucking times, you know. I mean, I'm always putting my foot in my mouth. I don't know. Do you do that? I mean,
one instance that really stands out. It was one of the dumbest things I've ever said in my entire life. Completely clueless and unaware. You know, it's a moment when you're just unaware. I was talking to Henry Butler, who was a great jazz pianist and a friend of ours and friend of our Joe Scarpinito's, New Orleans, great musician. And he was a wonderful dude, and we got along really well. And we were hanging out one night, and I was talking about how I just started driving. As I started driving late, I had just gotten a car. I didn't buy a car till I was 40 years old, right? And I actually asked him if Henry Butler was blind. And during the conversation, I actually asked him if he drove a car or not. And he just paused for a really long time. And then I realized what I said, and he started laughing. And I said, I'm sorry. And he just started laughing. You know, it was just, I just totally forgot, or I don't know what I was doing. And it was, I just felt, you know, ridiculous and humble. Oh no, he laughed. He thought he was a sweetheart. He thought it was kind of funny. But it's one of those moments where you just,
listen, I've had way too many of these. I was in Atlantic City with Vinny Pastore and Roger Haber, our attorney. And we had dinner. We were doing something out there. And the show had ended like maybe 3 weeks. You know, the show, the finale had aired 3 weeks ago. And here we are having dinner, getting up to leave. There's a couple next to us, a young girl. You know, maybe 25, really nice looking girl, and a guy maybe in his 50s. right? So I get up, I put my coat on or whatever it is, and the guy goes, ah, man, love you guys. I don't know what I'm going to do now on Sunday nights, now that the show's over. So I look at the girl, and I go, I could think of a whole lot of things to do on Sunday nights. And she says, that's my dad.
Oh. Oh.
Check, please.
That is horrible. That's
check,
horrible.
Check, please. Then.
Where do you go from there?
Listen, then, you know, I moved to Hawaii. I moved to Hawaii in the 80s, like 1985. I lived there for about a year. 84, 85, somewhere in there. And I lived there for a year. And I worked in this, I was a maitre d' in a restaurant, like a real high line, brand new place overlooking the city. It was like the fucking spot. Everybody came there.
In Honolulu?
In Honolulu. Beautiful, beautiful. I mean, this overlooking the water and the mountains and the lights. I mean, and every celebrity who came into Honolulu came there. It was a big spot, you know. And I moved from Vegas. I met the owner. So I moved there. And like I said, everybody would come in, you know. What's his name? I met Tiny Bubbles. What's his name?
Don Ho.
Don Ho came in with two girls. He lived with two girls.
Really?
He came in with two hoes. But he came in. He used to live with two women, you know. Like, and they,
wow,
they were all in, right? So I meet the guy comes in one night. He's drunk like a pig, blah, 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 just a fucking asshole. White guy, you know. And when I move back to Vegas, you know, I'm down at the gym, and there's a guy that I've known for years. And he says, hey, man, where you been? I haven't seen you. I said, I moved to Hawaii, you know. I was living in Hawaii for a while. I'm back now. He says, hey, did you ever meet Jerry Kaplan there, the car guy? I went, yeah, what a fucking asshole this guy is. He said, that's my dad. And, you know, I looked at him, and I couldn't even say nothing. I just said, listen, I'm sorry. Well, he was drunk. Your father was drunk. He was acting like an asshole. I mean, you know. Some things you can't back out of, you know?
No, you're in too deep. There's no shuffling off. There's no getting a, yeah.
I mean, easy. Yours is nothing compared to mine. I mean, another time I did a voiceover. I don't know if I might have told you. L. Ron Hubbard wrote a book, Scientology. So they call me up. My agent calls and says, listen, they want you to read this thing. It'll take about an hour. You know, the money was pretty good. So I went to Midtown, and I meet everybody, and oh, we're fans. Oh, the nice. There was three people, three guys. Great, we're fans. This and that. I said, all right. Before I get started, I got to go to the bathroom. So he's walking me because it's kind of hard. Those old buildings, you know, like on Broadway, you know. And I say, hey, are these fucking guys Scientologists? And he says, they're not. But I am.
They didn't try to convert you or anything? Did they try to seduce you? And
well, I told you. Afterwards, they asked me to do like an EPK, you know, electronic press thing. And the guy was asking me questions. And I was joking with him. I said, are you trying to convert me? You know, I never heard of the book. I never saw the book. I got paid. And it was like it disappeared. So I wonder, you know, I wonder if they would, you know, I don't think they want me.
But maybe people converted because of you. You heard your voice and decided to join up, and who knows?
I never heard the voice. I don't know where they use it, whether you can buy the book. I don't know anything about it. But I've had too many of these. I've got to stop. I've got to stop fucking up. I've had way too many, way too many things.
I was working the wedding place when I was a kid, and we were serving the bride's family, the mother of the bride, and it was a cocktail hour. So these weddings, these Italian weddings, they were long events. A cocktail hour starts at like 5 o'clock. The wedding might go to 1, 2 in the morning, and I'm serving baked clams. So I go to the bride's mother. She's wearing a pink gown. So she wants a baked clam. So I pick it up with the spoon, and I go to serve it, and it falls.
Oh.
And it goes like from her collarbone all the way down the middle of the, like a trail of grease that goes from, and now she's got to be in this dress for the next 7 hours. The family wanted to kill me. They had to move me to another part, a different wedding in another room, because that literally they wanted to kill me that night. She was so mad. There was nothing I could say, nothing I could do. It was an oil slick from, you know, like from her
Wow.
neck down to her belly button. It was horrendous.
Let's take a break and we'll come back.
Let's take a break. All right.
Chat this very, I think it was in Newark, very early in the morning. Very, very early in the morning. Me walking Bacala Senior in, the great Bert Young.
Bert Young, I mean, his real name was Gerald Tommaso De Luise is his real name.
That's a good name.
Been in so many great movies: Chinatown, The Gambler, Pope of Greenwich Village, Cinderella Liberty, Rocky, Once Upon a Time in America. He,
Back
you
to
know, he
school.
ran the.
Don't forget,
Oh,
back
was he
to
in Back to
school.
School?
Or
He was
Rodney.
in. He ran the marathon, New York Marathon, 1984.
Oh, I didn't know that.
Did you know
Did he?
that? He was friends with Johnny and my teacher, Elaine Aiken, and he used to come in and workshop because he wrote two plays. One was called SOS, Same Old Shit. The other one was called A Letter to Alicia and the New York City Government from a Man with a Bullet in His Head. That was the title of the play. And they were one-man shows, and he would come into our acting class back in the 80s and workshop them, do it for the class and get feedback and stuff like that. So he's
Very
you know,
underrated.
he's also a painter. He's a man of many talents, actually.
He's a very
Writer.
underrated guy. A lot of people just know him from Paulie and the Rocky movies. He's done so much. He really is a student of acting and a
A
teacher of
great
acting.
actor, a
And
great
he's
actor.
done so many things. And but like I said, though that role in the Rocky movies was so iconic and obviously made him a wealthy man, and he's done so much more before and after, and I really like him. You know, I was doing a book signing. He lives out in Long Island, and he came to see me, and it was just wonderful. You know, I introduced him from the stage. I was doing a talk, and I really I worked with him on another show too. I really like
But he's amazing in
Bert.
this episode. I mean,
Oh,
it's
just
perfect
great. And
casting.
let me
Yeah,
tell you
really
something
good.
too. I got a call from George Ann Walken asking me if my father was alive, my real father, and I said no, he had passed away. They were looking for Bacala Senior, and Bert had read, and they were still looking. I don't know if they weren't convinced, but they were still looking, and I can't imagine how good he was. It was just
Yeah,
amazing
he
to
was
me.
so good. He's perfect. It's so believable. I mean, he seems like he's really sick.
Oh,
You know, I
absolutely.
mean, Bert Young's a very honest actor. You know what I mean? Like, whatever he does, it's just you believe every minute. You know, there's no,
Absolutely.
it's like he's not an actor. It's really kind of amazing what he's, and every role is like that. He's always like that.
Just great, just great. You know, we're outside the church. Father Phil is holding mass for Febby, who was Carmela's uncle. He had cancer. Junior comes in. Bobby walks his father in. You know, you
Junior's
got
very
the
upset.
Junior's upset. You got the usual suspects there. You know, Carmela's mom and dad and Janice, and just one more funeral in Soprano land. You know, they come outside, and Bacala Senior's coughing badly. Bert Young. AJ says his friend's father. They froze his head until they find the cure for cancer. Now, supposedly, I remember this as a kid, Walt Disney, they said they froze his head and
They froze his whole body, I
his
think.
body, and then Ted Williams,
Yeah.
they froze his head. Now, tell me how does that work? So you
I
have the
don't think it
head,
does.
it's
I
frozen. What do you, where's the
don't think it
rest?
does work. I don't think it does work. You ever see Futurama? As they have all these people from like, Futurama takes place in the year
That's a
3000
cartoon.
something.
That's a cartoon.
That's by the Matt Groening who did The Simpsons.
Yeah.
So it takes place 1,000 years in the future, but there are people from our present, like Nixon and Bill Clinton and stuff, but it's just their heads in like jars. Ruth Bader Ginsburg, it's very creative the way they do it. So they're able to keep them alive. But it's just their head.
I mean, but what's that called? Cryogenics?
Cryogenics. I don't know. I don't think it's. I doubt we'll be seeing Walt Disney, you know, walking around.
But you know what's
Epcot
amazing? You
anytime
know,
soon.
Ted Williams, you know, one of the greatest baseball players ever. That's all people remember, you know, because there was a whole controversy. He had his head frozen, or you know, it's crazy stuff. But it's funny.
You're not
that
planning on that, are you?
Fucking right. Just my head. I'll motherfuck everybody. When they find the cure, you just put my head. We could continue this podcast.
You're going to do that last will and testament on video that I have to introduce if I'm alive.
We could do the podcast.
Funeral, right?
You just prop my head right on this table. It'll be just my head. That's it.
All right. AJ goes to look at the hearse. He wants to go check out the hearse. And they mentioned that Febby was 94 pounds. And Junior's like, well, he was always thin.
Yeah.
What do you expect?
He's a, you know, Janice says another toothpick.
Another toothpick. But there's that Avi Santo, who may be AS. He wrote that famous essay. He's that college professor that teaches The Sopranos. Fat fuck, why don't you go look in the mirror? And he talks about how being overweight is a symbol of virility and masculinity, while being thin is not, is the opposite, is being kind of, you know, like unhealthy or you know, a symbol of sickliness. It's kind of a theory that he proposes.
Well, I guess, you know.
He still hasn't contacted us.
You know, in the meantime, Junior says, what kind of way is that to talk about a sick person, when she calls, says another toothpick, you know? Carmela's father, gives the priest a boost. Did you notice that? He gives him an envelope. You know,
because it was Carmela's uncle, so it's their family. So they're, yeah.
Let me tell you about priests. Now, I was friends with a priest in Vegas. He married me and my wife, and he baptized both of my kids. And at the baptism of my daughter, the second daughter, I had the restaurant like from 2 to 5 only, because then they were going to open, so he had it for me in the afternoon. So I went to see the priest before time, Father White, beautiful guy, and I give him a couple of $100. His hand came out from under that robe faster than any maitre d' you ever saw in your life. He snatched that money. I said, Father, listen, you've got to end this thing. We can't drag on too long. Of course, people got to drive over to the restaurant. I don't have it for that long a time. So if this goes too long, you know, I'm fucked. He's, don't worry, my son. Don't worry. And we were friends. I used to compliment to the shows at the Riv. I used to, you know, put him in the restaurants. You know, we were friends, right?
You knew Father Pete. He was my favorite priest. Yeah. You know, he was he had the parish in Hell's Kitchen over there, 42nd Street. What was that, a Holy Cross? Or I forget the name of the church, but he was a great dude. I liked him a lot.
He was a good guy, real guy. That's what I liked, even about this Father.
A real guy.
He was a real guy, man. You could talk to this guy. Yeah. So I tell him, right? And so I had brought it up to my wife, you know, just in general. I just said, you know, I hope people have enough time to get over from the church to the restaurant. She said, well, I hope you didn't say anything to Father White about cutting it short. I went, no, I didn't say anything. You know, of course I'm lying. So we're in the church. There's about 150 people there. I swear to God. He's in there. He's doing his thing, the sermon. It's beautiful. I got all the friends, the family there. In the middle of nowhere, he's reading something, and he goes, hey, Steve, how am I doing on time?
He blew you up.
Fucking.
Threw you right under the bus.
Threw me under the bus. My wife gave me a dirty look. What did I tell you? But priests like to get a boost. You could tip a priest.
Sure. Well, you got a tip. I tipped Father Pete. He my parents had their 40th wedding at Shea Josephine across the street from his, and he came. He married them again, which you're not technically supposed to do. You're not supposed to remarry somebody. It's not really
Yeah, but
no,
I like,
you do something else. But he did it, you know.
I mean, I like when they bend the rules. It's okay.
He
I
bend
like.
The rules a little, and he was a good guy. He was a very good friend of Mickey Rourke. Mickey was very close to him. I think he was Mickey helped him towards the end. Father Pete got sick, and Mickey was very generous with his church. And Father Pete was cool, man.
Well, Father Pete, we were in Elaine's one night when I first moved back here, and I was with my wife and a few other friends, and he was there with his, you know, he had his collar on, his priest outfit, and he was drinking like a fucking drinking, man.
Well, it's not against the rules.
I'm not saying it was, but he was drinking heavy, telling dirty jokes. And then when we left, I said, hey, that Father Pete, he's a funny guy, nice guy. And my wife said, the guy's not a real priest. I went, of course he is.
Sure
she thought
is.
It was like he was in costume from Broadway. This was wearing his costume.
No, he was great. He was great.
We're outside the church. Bobby Sr., Bacala Sr. tells Tony that he's sick, that he's really sick with the coughing. And he says, thanks for taking care of Bobby. And Junior's out there, says he's been smoking Camels since he was in short pants. Janice, another Toothpick. And that's when Junior says, what kind of way is that to talk about a sick person? Junior's unraveling a little.
He's unraveling, and we find out why a little bit later. Yeah. There's a reason for that.
Vesuvio restaurant, Adriana says goodbye to the last customer. Artie's counting the receipts. They had a good night. He said, let's have a drink. She says, I'm not drinking tonight. I'm going to pass.
Great song there. Genius After Hours by Ray Charles. Very moody, atmospheric moment. You know, Johnny, Artie is very smitten by Adriana, obviously, we see in this scene. He says, you think I want to be stuck in this prison? And he says it, you know, laughing, smiling. Johnny plays this character so well. It's just he's always off kilter somehow. There's always, you know, you think about somebody who is not a good actor, how that character could have been just nothing, you know.
Yeah,
and Johnny
course,
just, you know, brings so much to him,
you
so
know,
much depth.
She says she's got to quit. You know, she was supposed to quit 2 weeks ago. Christopher doesn't want her to work anymore. He checks her forehead for fever when she doesn't want to drink. And she says she's going to go. She's got to go. She kisses Artie on the cheek like goodbye. I mean, she's completely innocent here. She's not leading him on at all. She's just a friend. And I guess Artie's certainly taking it the wrong way, you know.
She was working there for a couple of years, like 3 years.
Bobby and Junior playing checkers. And you see the way they shot that? Junior looks this big, and I look huge. I mean, of course I got the fat suit, but just the way they shot it, I look like I'm a giant, you know?
And it just seems, whenever we're in Junior's house, it seems depressing. You know, whether he's watching TV or if he's eating something and playing checkers, it's just this sad, miserable. You know,
well, I mean, it probably
miserable
hasn't been,
existence.
It hasn't been decorated since the 60s, probably.
It's
horrible. You know, it's just, you know, that's the way he lives, like these old guys. What's with you, Gloomy Gus?
Gloomy
you know,
Gus.
I tell him it's
Stop
my
speaking
father.
In anagrams.
Anagrams. you know, I say it's not, you know, my father, he's been retired, he can't do this hit. Of course, another famous Junior line. What is this? We're in the Navy? You know, Bobby offers to do the hit himself. He said, my father can't do this. He's got to do the hit on Mustang Sally. I never asked you for a favor. Would you ask Tony? It was
a really good scene. You both were really great. You know, it's a great moment.
Junior's getting depressed. He says, I'm getting depressed. You're making me depressed now. You know, he yells. He don't want to play checkers. We're in the Melvoin's office. You know, Junior goes to talk to Tony. You know, Junior tells Bobby, I'm still the boss of this family. He always brings that up.
But he caves on this. He caves into Tony. He doesn't. He lies. And then he says later, he lies later on and pretends that he,
you know,
was his idea, and it's not his idea.
you know, Tony tells him, what are you getting involved here? Bacala Senior's okay with this. He's done it 1,000 times. Gigi wants to do it. I don't want to cut his balls off. And he says, Junior tells him he's sick and he's dying. And the irony here of this line, Tony says, well, it'll give him something to live for. So here's a man dying, and him committing the murder will give him something to live for.
Right. Very disturbing, very weird.
You know, the irony there, the mentality. You know, okay, it'll be good for him. It's something for him to think about.
Well, and he says that later on when he's at Junior's house. Bacala Senior says, you know, he wants to do it. He says, you know, I'll feel good. It'll feel good feeling useful again. I'm dead anyway.
But, you know,
he says it himself.
But we're not talking about, you know, building a house about to murder someone.
Committing murder, yeah.
So, you know, I'm just saying the irony of it. Here's a dying man. It'll give him something to live for by killing another man.
Murdering his godson.
Correct. But it's godson, but he explains, Tony, when Tony comes to him for the okay, he explains it's in name only. He doesn't get
Yeah, but it's not like himself. It's a stranger. It's no, not like a, re- no. You know what I mean?
Well, he's friends with his father, obviously.
Godson means he's known him since he was a baby.
Yeah. I mean, he says, I did it as a favor to his father. So there is something there.
Sure.
Vesuvio's, this is a great scene. Great fucking scene.
A really fun scene. The first line, Christopher says, I'll take those Duncan Sheik records and shove them up around. What a weird, Terry Winter line, just out of the blue, specific, detailed, weird, out of nowhere. And then he calls him Wolfgang Fuckface.
Yeah.
Tony calls Artie, which is obviously a reference to Wolfgang Puck.
I don't like Wolfgang Puck.
The founder of Spago's.
I don't like him.
You know him?
Fucking right, I know.
I've never met him.
Well, first of all, I met the guy 20 times. 20 times, if not more.
And he never knows who you are.
Never knows who I am. I knew him before I was an actor because he used to come around the Crazy Girls. We had that topless show, and he was friends with the producer. I remember a Christmas
party. What topless show?
It was a thing called
Vegas?
Crazy Girls.
And it was called Crazy Girls?
Crazy Girls.
A horrible name. What does that mean? Was it comedy or was it strippers or what was it?
They dance. They take their tops off. Yeah, it's a topless review. A review. It's not a strip club. It's called Crazy Girls. It's been going for 25 years. They had a comic in there, so the show was there. You know, the girls were there for years, and he came to a Christmas party I was at. I remember it was like a Moroccan restaurant. Everyone was sitting on the floor, the girls. He loved them fucking broads, I'll tell you that. I met him before I was an actor. Then I met him at Spago. Then after the Emmy, SAG Awards, we used to go to Spago in Beverly Hills.
HBO used to throw their party at Spago in Beverly Hills.
He never knew me, never remembered me. I would say, hey, don't you remember Crazy Girls, No Bad? Never remembered me. So he is Wolfgang Fuckface to me anyway, because he's one of them guys. If you're not a big star, he don't give a shit about you. So that's it.
Wow. All
right. I don't think
I ever met him.
You had to meet him at the party. He was always there.
I wouldn't remember much of that.
He loves I got you. He loves the limelight, you know. Hey, Artie, Artie is just completely fucking bombed. His coat is
fucking. He's rubbing me a massage. I mean, I you see Christopher's laughing, but I remember I was just hysterical during that. Because some takes he went further than others, and he just, it goes way beyond anything appropriate, and it's hilarious. It was so much fun. That's good.
Do you think, Artie, obviously very obnoxious. He's drunk. He pulls up a chair. He calls Christopher a cocksucker. You better be good to that girl. Do you think this makes it even worse because Christopher's a made guy now? And Artie's treating him like just another schmuck, like a kid. He's rubbing his head calls him a piece of shit. Very disrespectful. Made guy or not. Christopher's trying it's to not stay calm. This is
Tony's trying to keep him calm, and then it just blows up.
He's telling Artie, take it easy. You know, come on. Artie pulls up a chair. He's drinking their wine. I got to be honest. I'm surprised Christopher didn't jump sooner. Christopher was very patient.
Well, Tony's really trying to hold him back. You see, Tony, you know, he's just like, calm down, and it's very funny though.
Oh, it's great.
It's a hilarious scene. It's great. And Johnny's just...
Christopher...
Finally, Christopher blows, and Tony breaks it up. And then Tony smacks Artie, and it's like, you're out of line, you know? And he starts crying. I loved her. I love her now. And he's just like...
Maybe if I
don't
had
Don't ever
hair.
Say that. Hair like... He says, you could have had hair like Casey Kasem. It doesn't matter. And he said... He says, don't ever tell anybody that ever.
Well, he says she's a young girl, and she is. Probably Adriana's probably 28 or so. Artie's whatever age at 40, this point.
Yeah. And married. Yeah.
And married with two kids. And I think Johnny talked to us about the scene where he really smacked him. He smacked Johnny a bunch of times. You know, he would smack him and then, you know, kiss his head. So it's a great, great, great scene. And Johnny's great in that.
Yeah, and the way Jim plays it, you know, with the, you know, he's straightening him out, you know, he's going to straighten him out, but he also loves him, and he has compassion for him.
And he tells him, you know, call me tomorrow. I have a business proposition for you. Right. So we're at Zellman's office. Tony calls Zellman. What's the story with the speeding ticket? You know, just take care of
Zellman,
the ticket.
He calls Mr. Spears. That's his code name.
He's
Tony's
in his office.
Mr. Spears.
Tony says, just fix the fucking ticket. You know, I mean, he's giving him a whole bunch of song and dance. The assemblyman. We're at Junior's house. Bobby's setting the table. He said, where's your father? He stopped by the little details. He stopped by the bakery to pick up a shortcake. You know?
A shortcake.
He says,
he never comes empty handed.
He's.
Which is great. That's just a great line.
He says, did you talk to Tony? And, of course, he wants to save face, Junior. He says, no, I decided against it. This life comes with responsibilities, Bobby. So a lot of times Junior talks to Bobby like Bobby's a 10-year-old.
Yeah, they have a very strange relationship. You know, right? They're like a married couple, practically. You know? Yeah, he does.
So Junior, you know, he says this comes with responsibilities. Bobby says, I was asking for me, you know, so he's explaining.
And Bobby's a little upset, right? That he didn't, you know, he didn't help him out.
He doesn't ask for a favor. He's asking if you can do this for me, I'll do the hit. Bobby was prepared to do the hit. He never killed anyone before. You know, he was prepared to do the hit to save his father. You know, he doesn't want to admit that Tony turned him down, Junior. He doesn't want to admit to Bobby. He wants to save face. Here comes, at the door, here comes Bacala Sr. He's coughing because there's stairs outside. He's spitting up blood. Junior,
his
when he sees the blood, he's panicked he is panicked when he sees the blood. Holy shit. Call the doctor. John Kennedy.
He said, I'll call John Kennedy at St. Barnabas, Kennedy. The head of oncology.
And Bacala says, the cure is worse than the illness, which a lot of people feel that way. Bacala is crying. He hears what his father says, that he's dead anyway. And he runs into the other room crying. It's just kind of a funny scene. The big fat belly, this big, huge guy. Crying like a baby, you know, and you know when we were shooting the scene, Jack interrupted him kind of a few times, not in a bad way, but just, and he said, please, Jack, let me try to do this for a second. Yeah, you know, he had something in mind, Bert. You know, he said, give me a second, just give me a second, and you know, he figured it out. But you know what I mean, like.
Yeah, I understand. I don't like to be over-directed that way. Let the actor find it.
Yeah, well,
first.
That's what he was trying to find.
You know what I mean?
Find
Give it. You a shot, and then, but don't interrupt the actor and when they're trying to
and
find
so
what,
he,
you know,
he
figure out
said,
what they're doing.
Yeah, and he just said, Jack, give me a minute. I'm trying to do something here. That was an incredible scene. He's, you know, he's coughing. You believe every really second
very,
that
very
this guy is
yeah.
dying, you know?
100%.
Or if Charmaine and Artie. Charmaine's at the door filling in for Adriana. Artie comes over. He scolds her. He doesn't like that she's wearing glasses and kind of looks kind of...
He kind of wants to get divorced, it seems. He just seems like he's done with her. He's sick of her, you know, personality and her attitude, you know, and there's something has shifted for him, it seems.
Well, I mean, he mentions that his wife, you know, he mentions to Tony when he said, I love Adriana, he mentions to Tony that his wife, you know, no good, blah, 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 blah. And now he's telling her about this new business venture. Paul Newman started with salad dressing. Now they're over $100 million a year. And she says, what do you know about
mass
production?
Which is not a good comparison, no.
What do you know about mass production? I have an associates in business, for God's sake. Right. Going into business with a gangster isn't a risk. It's a guaranteed disaster. She's talking sense. She makes
She's
sense.
Talking sense. He wants to call it Satrials, which is a sign that if he can easily get, you know, tossed aside.
Of course. Products know, that the... start market research. Tony said products that start with the letter V make people think of vagina.
I don't think that's true. Do you?
I don't think so. And but why wouldn't they want to call it Vesuvios? Because probably Tony is going to toss him at some point. Satrials?
Yeah.
Was it that famous a place, Satrials? Pork store?
I don't know.
Charmaine
maybe
doesn't
he just wants the control.
Doesn't want to do business with gangsters. Be happy in thine own self. You know, Artie is just not that smart a guy. He's a dreamer. He's not that smart. You know, we see as the series goes on, not the brightest.
Yeah.
Good heart.
But the restaurant's good. You know, he runs a good restaurant. You know what I mean? He's
good heart.
You know.
He's there. He's in the back cooking. He's busting his ass. Hard-working family. He wants to dabble with this gangster thing. We know what happens there. You never come out on top. We know what could happen. She's trying to protect him. We're in the dining room of Vesuvio. Johnny Sack and the crew, Ralphie, Paulie, Gigi, they're having dinner. Johnny, who said he wasn't going to stick his beak in, is now sticking his beak in. What's this I hear? You got old man Bacala making a comeback. Paulie says it wasn't. He didn't hear it from me, which is probably exactly where he heard it from. Paulie, he's got a big mouth.
Oh, I don't think so. I think he heard it from Ralph, because it looks like Ralph and he are in cahoots to some degree.
Yeah, but Paulie's always
party at
up.
Johnny Sack's party.
Yeah. Yeah.
They went off on the side, and here they're kind of taking each other's, you know, Ralphie has a bad taste in his mouth that he's, you know, been
bypassed.
Gigi's been bypassed. He calls Jagoots. What is he? Refers to Gigi. Then he says he'll do it. Ralphie says, I'll do the hit. He volunteers for it. I think Ralphie told him. I don't think Paulie would go against Tony in favor of Johnny Sack.
Oh, no, absolutely not. I didn't mean it that way. Just that Paulie, he's got a big mouth. He talks a lot. I mean, you know, he's the one that told him that that Christopher and Jackie Jr. did the robbery in last episode. You know, Paulie's talks a lot. That's all. He didn't do it maliciously.
I don't know. That's a little different, though, because that he's talking within the family there. This is going outside the family. Because Johnny Sack's not in the Soprano family.
No. Ralphie's mocking Gigi. He's very disrespectful. Tell him bad jokes. What's he going to gum him to death? And Tony kind of tells him, that's how it's going to be. Shut up. And that's that. Gigi's pissed. I don't know. I don't know how he gets a... Ralphie would have been gone if I was the boss already. I would have... If I was the boss, I would just start fucking whacking people if they said anything bad to me. Even the least bit. Yeah, all right, he's gone. I would call Paulie, Silvio, take care of Ralphie, take care of this guy.
No, I wouldn't have lasted when I first met you and I didn't acknowledge
you. No,
you
would have been
properly
gone.
Or to your satisfaction. I would have been gone.
I would have made
enough.
The call. Yeah, I would have said, this fucking little fucking prick from Mount Vernon high-hatted me. Let's get rid of him. Boom. Another guy, a waiter.
That's how you interpreted it.
Listen, if I was at the wedding and you spilled the clam stuff on my mother or my wife, you would have been
that
gone.
That would have been.
Gone.
Luckily, it wasn't a wise guy wedding. I might have been gone.
Whack this guy. If you're going to use it, if you're going to be it, use it. We're in the Fountains of Wayne, which is the outdoor lawn ornament store. We see Officer Wilmore, who is working there part-time.
Moonlighting, yeah, working part-time. Tony calls him Shaft.
Shaft, what are you? You're on a stakeout, you know, being a smart aleck. He tells him, you know, he needs, you know, I no longer get overtime thanks to you. You know, and Tony says, well,
he's been transferred, to property, to property room, no overtime. So he's gotten really fucked because of Tony's call.
And Tony says, not that it matters, and just so you know, I didn't tell him to do any of that shit. Yeah, well, that's very kind of you. Real smug, you know, the Zellman obviously went too far. I don't think this is what Tony wanted, but, you know.
No, and he feels guilty, but he's, you know, he fucked this guy over big time.
He's a solid guy, a cop, and he doesn't have overtime, and now he's working in the fucking lawn store. What could he be making? Now, in this scene, there is a clerk comes over, and he says, Leon, Dutton's name. Leon, take your lunch at 2. Okay? Take your lunch at 2. It's a guy named Eric Weiner, and he did a video on YouTube, which I'm going to show you, and it's called One Line on the Sopranos. The guy's a writer. And from this, Terry saw this and cast him in Boardwalk Empire. He did 10 episodes. It's called One Line on the Sopranos.
My agent called me up and said, you got the part. You're on the Sopranos, and next week you start. I said, am I a mob boss who packs a 9? He said, no, you're a store clerk, and you have one line. Got the script that night, read the whole thing through. Saw my awesome line, Leon, take your break at 2. So I practiced the line like any actor would. Leon, take your break at 2. Ooh, that one was good. One line on the Sopranos, that makes me more gangster than you. Leon, take your break. Leon, take your break.
Leon, take your break at 2.
Pretty clever.
So this led to him getting a role on Boardwalk.
He auditioned.
And
he was a writer.
Parlayed this.
Writer and actor. So people out there, it's not handed to you. He's a writer-actor. He comes up with this clever, very clever, right?
Very creative, very clever, yes.
And,
very funny.
He auditions for Boardwalk, and he winds up doing 10 episodes, so good for him.
You can't wait for the phone to ring. You got to be proactive. For all you aspiring actors,
if you wait, you're going to be waiting a long time, my friends.
Yeah.
Soprano House. Carmella's going shopping.
She's going to Fortune Off, which means she's going to probably be buying jewelry.
She said,
she's
when
mad
you...
still. I think she's kind of, it's kind of a little bit of revenge, right? You know, she's going to spend the money, buy some jewelry, make herself happy because she's pissed at Tony.
When he says, when are you coming back? She says, when I'm finished, when I'm done. So he tells him, Tony, you know, I ran into the traffic cop.
Zellman's in the schwitz. He's in the
now, you know, in the background.
He's in the bathhouse.
In the background is Dominic Chianese standing in a towel. If you see, if you notice, there's an older guy, beautiful guy. I don't know his name. White hair. He was Dominic standing the whole time, and they gave him a little something. He's in a towel in the steamer.
In the schwitz.
Yeah. Junior, the standard's in the background. Tony feels guilty. He got the cop demoted. It's a little harsh, he says. Zellman, says, I talked to the unit manager. He's a bit of a rabble-rouser. I talked to his unit commander. He's got some mental illness. He's a rabble-rouser.
Mental illness, which is ironic because Tony's coming from the therapist when he got pulled over with dealing with his own mental illness, and now maybe he even feels. But the fact that he's in the sauna, another just great. You know, you could have had him behind the desk again. You could have had him at home on the couch in the sauna, which means they had to get the set, put people in costume and towels, and do the whole thing. But the detail, the specificity,
that's what makes this show. That's what's incredible. Little things that you mean nothing. You know what I mean?
Right.
You know,
you
even
could easily say he's in his car. He's in his office. You know what I mean? Yeah.
Did you notice in the scene to go back a second where Bacala Senior comes over and Tony's setting the table and then Bobby's setting the table and they're talking. Junior puts his hand back into the garbage disposal and he pulls out a peach pit. Back to that garbage disposal.
Right, what you think was he was going to yell at Bobby? Why? What do you, you know, put the peach pit? It just doesn't go any. But another great detail, yeah.
I don't know where it was going. Just such a very real detail. That's what happens, you know. Bert Young, Bobby Senior pulls up to the house. They're watching
this
Sally.
Whole thing from here, the next, all the way to the crash. Just incredible sequence. Great filmmaking here. This is really great acting, great writing, great directing. It's the next several scenes are just incredible.
He pulls up. Mustang Sally's with, what's it, Carlos? Carlos. They're watching Sally, Jesse, Raphael. He knocks on the door. He's up the stairs. Again, he says, more fucking stairs. So he's coughing, got him coughing again. The Carlos is smoking, and Bacala tells him, you know, you shouldn't, you know, whatever he says, you shouldn't be doing that. And he says, which is one of the, this line I hate. People say this all the time. You got to die from something. You got to die from something.
Right. Which means I'm just going to be reckless and not care about anything.
I'm going to die from something, so I might as well smoke. Yeah. I'm going to drink myself. I'm going to die sooner or later. Might as well. It's just a stupid remark to me. Got to die from something.
Yeah.
So he's talking. He tells Mustang Sally he got him a pass. Mustang Sally says, I'll tell Tony.
Believes him. Yeah.
I'll do anything for you. I'll do anything for Tony. Bah, bah, bah. Next time, I would have yelled four. It makes a bad joke. Bert Young's great in this. Just great. I mean, just, you know.
Yes, he's really good. And he, you know, he plans it out perfectly. He tells him to go get him a glass of water, let the water run so there's noise. And then he walks over. He shoots him, but he grazes him because he's distracted by Carlos, right? But this whole thing is staged really well, too. The way he shoots him, the way he grazes him, Mustang Sally attacks him. They're fighting.
There's a pack of cigarettes.
It's very brutal.
Pack of Marlboro, as they're fighting, you see it in the bowl. It's a pack of Marlboro there. I don't know if you noticed that. You know, Carlos came out to break it up. That got him killed. He might have got away with it, but it got him killed. Carlos, wrong place at the wrong time. Bacala Senior, he grazes his ear. They struggle. It's a bloody scene, a bloody mess. Blood everywhere. He kills.
Very graphic, yeah.
Mustang Sally. He kills Carlos. Come on with your smart remarks now. And then he lights a cigarette. And he's in ecstasy when he smoked that cigarette. You see that? Probably hasn't
he's
had
in
one
ecstasy.
In a while.
He's almost like moaning in ecstasy. And, you know, and then he's got his inhaler. I knew a guy, I had a friend who had severe asthma. Really, I think he had like something worse than like CPOD or whatever, emphysema maybe even. I think it was emphysema. And he was a chain smoker. So he'd be alternating between the inhaler and the cigarette. Jeez, it was insane, just insane. He didn't live that long after that. You know, he died not a few years after I met him, and he was doing that kind of thing.
Well, you got people on oxygen that smoke, and you know, I mean, I guess. Listen, I never smoked. I don't know. I don't know what that addiction's about. You know,
it's a hard thing. It's very hard to quit. Yeah. I think smoking's one of the hardest addictions to break.
You know, I mean, very hard. People. They don't care. You know, my mother was a crazy smoker. Even when she was sick, she didn't care. You know, she did not care.
Anybody who's trying to quit, there's a book called, it's a horrible title, but it's called The Easy Way to Stop Smoking. It's by a guy named Alan Carr, C-A-R-R. And that book, I quit because of that book. It took me a couple of attempts, but that book works. You may have to read it two or three times.
And what is it?
A lot of people... It breaks down smoking into the fact that it's addiction and brainwashing. And it breaks it down and puts it in a way that makes you understand what you're doing. And it just, it's helped a lot of people. If you're struggling, read that book. Get it now. It's a great book.
And you smoked for a long time, didn't you? You were a heavy smoker.
I didn't start smoking until I was like 26.
Oh, wow.
I didn't smoke till I had a girlfriend who was a smoker.
And well, you have one used pack
to roll,
a day?
She used to roll her own cigarettes. So I started roll. I used to like it, rolling her own. And then I got into it. And then I just, yeah, I smoked for about from 26 till 2003. So whatever, 37,
was it,
like about
was
12
a
years.
Pack a day, two packs?
Unless I was up all night hanging out, then it might have been two packs, yeah.
You know what? I've never smoked, ever. Ever.
It's a horrible. It's the one of the worst things you can do for me.
Yeah, I don't
listen,
like smoke.
At least, you know, other things, you know, and it doesn't really do anything. You know, it just relieves the addiction because you're addicted to nicotine. Yeah. So smoking relieves the addiction. You don't get a high from it or anything. It's not like marijuana or alcohol where you get a somewhat pleasurable buzz or something. It's not like that.
Is that book better than Shantex? Like Ray Liotta says.
I never took Shantax. I never took drugs for smoking. No. I don't know.
Ray Liotta swears
by
Shantax.
The book is done. Millions of people have quit because of Alan Carr's book.
Ah, okay.
The
What's
easy
it called
way
again?
To stop smoking. The Easy Way to Stop Smoking.
Okay. Very good. Bobby Sr. All right. So they have the big fight. He kills Carlos. He's out.
Really well done. Pete Bocosi, our stunt coordinator, did a great job designing this fight and made it look really real, really sloppy.
Absolutely.
And then very bloody and disturbing as well. Yeah.
Bacala, he's got the cigarette. He's smoking. He's humming. Sister Golden Hair by America, who worked for me at the Riviera once. Nice.
Which is a weird song. I mean, this is a really great use of music here because it's just, it's not, it goes kind of against the moment, but it just, it's an innocent song. It's kind of a sweet song. He's singing, he's humming along with it.
He's humming,
he's
happy.
Just committed this brutal murder. He's a sick man. It's just, it kind of goes against all the emotion, but yet it works. You know, it's genius. Great, great choice.
He's happy. He did this thing. He's legitimately, you can see he's happy, starts coughing, throws the cigarette out the window, drops the inhaler. He needs it. From coughing, he passes out first. And because he passes out, he hits the pole and dies. And
the car goes out of control. He hits the pole. The sign, your ad here, falls. And so with a big sign high up just falls really hard, crashes. And the song keeps playing because it's on the radio, which is really cool.
And he dies happy.
Which I love that.
He dies happy and satisfied.
Feeling useful. Yeah, he had a cigarette. He felt useful. He dies happy.
Junior's house. You see Bobby sitting on the couch. He looks like Humpty Dumpty. He's broken up about his father. He says, I had to go all the way to Staten Island to identify the body. They didn't clean him up. He had bits of glass in his hair, which...
You did a great job in that scene, Steve.
Thank you.
That's a heavy scene and a sad one. Yeah.
Thank you. So he's sitting there. I mean, for a guy like Bobby, a big, sensitive guy, on top of that, he's got to go out to Staten Island to do this by himself. And Junior's asking all kinds of questions. Did he die from the cancer? Where's the metastasis? What's it called? Metastasis?
Metastasis.
How advanced
was the metastasis? Metastasis.
Yeah.
Anyway, he's asking these questions. We find out why he's asking these questions. He wants to know, did he die from the cancer?
Or did he die from
the accident? Because there's a very specific reason why he wants to know that.
You know, he says he was a good friend. He was a good man. He was a good friend. He's asking him questions. Bobby says, all due respect, what do you care about the details? And he's calm, he's calm, he's calm. And then Junior just fucking snaps. And he starts wrecking the house and throwing shit all over the place.
He starts breaking shit.
And Bobby is just, Bobby's just sitting there like kind of in disbelief. We're at the audience. Charmaine, they argue, they're in the restaurant. Charmaine's looking kind of dowdy. She's got the glasses on. He's saying you didn't say goodbye to the people. You know, he's comparing her to Adriana, obviously. They have an argument.
She says, you've had a hair across your ass, which I always hear, up your ass. I've never heard across your ass. Have you? Across your ass?
Yeah, I've heard it, but the one up your ass is more common.
More common, right?
Yeah. You know, what are you going to do? He brings it up. What are you going to do, divorce me? So he brings up that divorce thing first. That's what you want. She snaps, and the whole restaurant hears it. It's pretty embarrassing, you know.
They hear it. This is, and that really well acted. Catherine Narducci's fantastic in this scene. Really honest, the hurt, you know, the anger, the hurt. It's all there, and as is Johnny. Great song, the Vern Baker's Jim Dandy, which is going on, which is another, you know, using music to great effect, because it's just, it just adds a whole other emotional level to the scenes, you know, the way, when you pick the right song and you pick something that elevates it, and that certainly does.
You know, Artie, another bad move. It's a really good scene between the two of them. Catherine Narducci has done such good work. I mean, really, really.
Yeah.
I mean, you believe every moment of all of this. I mean, it's not like you go,
yeah,
you know, when someone says, you know, I see the guy acting, I don't see anybody acting.
No, they're both real and wonderful, and it's you know, it's like Artie's midlife crisis, basically, is what's happening here. You know what I mean? He's questioning what he's gotten himself into. He wants to expand with Tony. She doesn't want to do it. He's in love with this young girl. He's got this, you know, his wife is, you know, they're not getting along. It's very honest portrayal of that, I think.
The grass is always greener, my friend.
Grass is always greener. Doctor's office.
Junior waits.
Waiting. Tony arrives, yeah, with AJ.
He brings the last of the sweet corn for Junior. AJ's there. Junior asks AJ, you know, to step outside. He tells him that he's got stomach cancer, the big casino.
I have cancer, the big casino, which, yeah, I've never heard that before. Have you heard that before?
No, except for here. Because he said, Junior has said it numerous times, yeah. The big casino, when'd you find out? He said he found out a few days before Olivia's funeral. How bad is it? You know, Junior.
And Tony's very affected by it. He's very sad. You see that he loves his uncle at first, but no, just knowing his uncle's going to has cancer, he's moved. He tugs him. You see that he loves his uncle despite all the shit that's gone down. He does actually love this guy.
And then he figures out that the reason he didn't want Bacala to make the hit because this thing's come in threes.
Because he wanted Bacala Sr. to die of cancer, because he would have been the third after Jackie Aprile, Febby, and old Bacala would have been the third. Somehow, you know, it's this superstition that's very bizarre.
People believe that. Are you superstitious?
No, but
I'm superstitious.
Like what? Oh, yeah. How?
You can't put shoes on the table.
I don't believe in any of that.
I'll listen to the same.
You know, the Russians are superstitious. My wife, you can't whistle in the house.
Uh-huh, okay.
No whistling in the house. And you don't wish somebody like a happy birthday or like a happy anniversary before the actual birthday.
Okay.
You don't never toast somebody happy birthday unless it is the birthday, not before.
When you toast someone, you got to look them in the eye.
With water. You got to toast with alcohol. That's another superstition.
If I have a, you can't, this one, if you're in a restaurant and the waiter pours your wine or champagne or even water this way.
Which way? I didn't see that.
Can you see this? See my hand?
Yeah. Yeah.
So you would pour the wine that way. If the waiter pours it that way, don't drink that wine.
Don't drink that
wine. That's very bad. I'm dead serious. And people will send it back. Don't go the opposite way. You go overhand. So there's a whole, one day we'll talk about superstitions. I got a bunch of them. If something good happened.
I don't believe in superstitions.
Something bad happened. Okay, hey, we believe what we believe.
Yeah, you know? I think you, I don't know. I just don't see why that would matter.
I think something like
don't wish somebody happy birthday before their birthday. I see where that comes from, because then it's like, you know, the tragedy would be if somebody dies the night before their wedding or before their birthday. So you're kind of, you know, that kind of, but things like, you don't pour this way or that, I don't see how that could.
All right, well, listen, sometimes I'm watching a ball game, watching a Yankee game. The other team hits a home run. I had the sound on. I'll shut the sound off. And sometimes it works out that way.
Yeah.
Listen, yeah. I'm a little fucking crazy. You know that? I can't help myself. But I am superstitious. I've got quite a bit of them. If something good happens,
you know, my friend's father was a gambler, and he was, you know, the gamblers are very superstitious.
Sure.
Really superstitious.
Sure, of course.
And, you know, and his wife, you know, if he had an argument with his wife, she would say, well, now you're not going to win tonight at the casino. I'm going to put the evil eye. And he'd get really mad at her.
Well, that's wrong. She's wrong. That's bad. That's really bad. That's really bad.
She would have power over those dice.
If I was a mob boss, I would have her whacked for saying that. She'd be on the list.
Power over the dice? I don't believe it.
Listen, there's a million things. The guys, if he's on a winning streak, a poker player in Vegas, he'll wear the same clothes for a week. Horse player. They'll wear the same clothes. A lucky hat.
Horse players are very,
a lucky
very
hat. My lucky shoes. I'm wearing my lucky socks. I met a girl.
Do you have lucky clothes?
A guy says he met a girl. He went out. He got laid. I'm going to wear them same socks. I wear this shirt every time I wear
it.
Then
he won't get laid if he keeps wearing those socks, unless he washes them.
Well, of course he washes it. There's a million
things. Do you have lucky clothes?
Not lucky clothes, but I'll listen to music, like certain things that something good happened or whatever. I'll listen to that same song.
Like what? Which song?
I have one Dave Matthews.
What's your lucky song?
Dave Matthews. I'll listen to him, there's some of that.
Like before an audition or something like that?
Yeah, exactly. Something good. I got a job. I was listening to that on the way. I'll continue. Dave Matthews is one that I listen to.
And constantly. You think the song had something to do with you getting the job?
Maybe.
Put you in a good state of mind, maybe?
Maybe.
Inspired you? I see that. That I see.
Maybe.
That
I mean,
see.
There's all kinds of stuff. I don't know. I don't know what works, what doesn't work. I mean, who's to say it doesn't? You believe in ghosts. I don't believe in ghosts.
I don't believe in ghosts.
You told me you believed in ghosts. I don't believe in fucking ghosts. Boo! You scared? Did I scare you just now?
I do believe, you know, I do believe in Bigfoot. Bigfoot is real.
You
I'm
think
convinced
so?
Of that.
Really?
Oh, yeah.
Well,
Without a doubt.
He does those commercials for beef jerky.
No, not that Bigfoot. The real Bigfoot. There's a lot of evidence.
You really believe in Bigfoot?
The Native Americans called him Sasquatch. Well, you think they just came out of the blue with that name? They knew him.
So you really believe? Okay, but
the
you
Yeti
don't
in the Himalayas, they have the Yeti. It's the same thing.
But you don't believe in
Bigfoot is documented. I've seen footage of Bigfoot, real footage.
Hey, see, I don't believe in that, but that's okay. We all got what we got. That's what makes the world go round, my friend. We got that. Okay. Tony's on the phone with right away. He says, don't tell anyone, Junior says.
Don't tell anyone. He says, of course not.
Because, but you can see when Tony says, of course not, that he's going to tell someone. He can't wait
he's
to get gonna out
tell
of
everybody.
He of says, course. Because people treat you like a non-entity. If they know you got cancer, then you, and a lot of people are like that. They don't want people to know because then you get that pity. And a lot of people live for the pity, and then there's people that don't want the pity.
That's right.
Right? You know?
He doesn't want it.
Tony and Janice are on the couch drinking wine, talking about their family, who died, who doesn't die. Livia used to say another toothpick. That's where that phrase came from. Comes in threes. The Holy Trinity, Father, Son, Holy.
Comes in threes, 3 o'clock. Here comes in trees, the Trinity. So that's a whole thing, yeah.
She asked what happened to Sal Bump and Sarah, Big Pussy. And the word is, you know, witness protection. That's the answer to everything. Everyone who they killed is in the witness protection program.
Witness protection program.
All right.
It's a convenient answer, though.
Yes, it is.
You can't really disprove it.
Absolutely. Remember, Ma didn't like compliments, giving them or taking them. Because maybe at any minute, boom, you're dead. She said, would you like to pray with me? Would you like to pray with me? Thank God, you know, she found Christ. Another crazy moment. Tony's falling asleep. He wants to get the fuck out of there, you know.
Yeah. He's not going there with Janice, no. He knows that she's full of shit.
Meadow is singing. She's doing laundry. She's walking down to the basement. She picks up the lamp that is... She picks
bugged
up the lamp
the
that is bugged by the FBI. They're listening. Her 10-speed got stolen at school. A black guy stole it. She didn't want to tell them. Somehow Carmela got her out of her. They told Tony. He left.
This makes Tony happy.
Absolutely.
He gloats over this. You know,
here
proves
is
his somehow.
You know, I told you so. That's so fucking racist, she says. He gets big joy out of it being a black guy, you know.
Yeah,
he would have been pissed off if it was a white guy, you know.
Yeah, he's using this as his argument against
you know. And FBI, who the Sopranos make the FBI look like morons. I'll be honest.
These guys, I mean, not really Cubitoso, more the guys in the, you know, the lower guys.
And he says, what are they doing in the basement? And I don't think they are in the basement. And then Tony says, now you've got something, he tells Carmela, now you have something to tell, to rap me out about in therapy. So Carmela could tell Melfi about this racist moment.
Right. Yeah, it's not a good dynamic right now. The therapy thing with the marriage counseling is not, doesn't seem like it's going to help.
Artie and Adriana are having dinner.
They're at an expensive restaurant. It's probably in the city, I imagine, because they're not, you know, to get away from everybody to do this clandestine thing because he could get in a lot of trouble.
Well, I got to tell you something. I'm very surprised at Adriana lying to Christopher. This is a big lie that she's going to have dinner with Artie, an intimate dinner. It's a nice restaurant.
Well, she might have said, I want to take you out to say goodbye to Aunt.
So
thank
I,
you
but
for
still,
all your thing.
But
yeah,
still,
it's a mistake.
She lied. I mean, if Christopher somehow found that out, that's trouble. I mean, you know, you lied. You flat out lied, you know.
Flat out lied. Great song, Concierto de Aranjuez by Joaquin Rodrigo, which is a very great, very famous Spanish classical song. It was done by Miles Davis on the Sketches of Spain album. It's a really good song. Very romantic, expensive. They're probably in Manhattan, I would imagine.
Artie has an earring. She says, is that an earring? Says, I've had it for a long time. Obviously, he's trying to look younger and hipper. He holds her hand, touches her hand. She pulls it away.
Very bold. Artie's being
very bold. He tells her he's going into business with Tony. And if she doesn't get married, he can use a sexy VP. He's going to hire her. He's going to hire her as a sexy vice president already.
Vice president.
He's already hiring people, Artie. So she pulls away. She gets it. I don't think she gets it at first that Artie's hitting on her. But she gets it soon enough.
Now she gets it and she's uncomfortable.
She's got to go to the bathroom. But a big lie saying she was out with her friend Cindy. Big lie.
Yeah.
We're in the restaurant. It's Johnny Sack, Zelman.
Zelman and
dinner.
Tony.
Mentions the cop. He's bitching about losing his overtime. He's got some black officer squad looking into the case. He's saying, I could get it squashed. I could put him back, get him
reinstated on his old job. And Tony says, now Tony is being influenced by Meadow and what happened to Meadow, I think, right? Obviously.
Yeah, of course.
That's what's happening.
You know, he said, fuck him. He got what he deserved. FBI Agent Harris tells Cubitosa that the lamp is gone, they've been neutralized. Very surprised with Tony. I mean, over the bike, you know, it's, you know, I mean,
yeah,
you know, Petty. he felt, you know what I mean? This guy had nothing to do with that at all. You know, nothing to
He's being petty, and he's just saying, fuck it, you know?
Junior's house. Junior is happy. He's going to watch a movie. He's got his sandwich. He's got his coffee. He's got the blanket. You could see he's almost giddy. He's all alone. It's quiet.
He's watching, yeah, Devil at 4 o'clock with Frank Sinatra and Spencer Tracy, directed by Mervyn LeRoy, who also directed Little Caesar, which is a movie that we've shown on, you know, that's the Sopranos. It's been on the Sopranos. He also produced and had to take over direction of The Wizard of Oz.
Oh, really?
And directed many, many, many movies. Yeah, big time director. But yeah, Junior looks cozy. He's getting into it, and Bacala shows up for the funeral.
He comes in. He's dressed up. Junior, you're not ready. I have my family in the car. I'm not going. What do you mean you're not going? I take this as a personal insult. In the meantime, Junior's trying to watch the TV the whole time.
He's trying to look around.
He's trying to look around. He can give two shits what Bobby's saying. So Junior uses the cancel when it's convenient for him. He told
Tony. Now he tells Bobby.
Yeah. All right. Well, you know, now how do you feel? Now, how do you feel? I got cancer. He calls him a Weisenheimer.
Weisenheimer.
You know? Yeah, Weisenheimer. Now, how do you feel now? You know, so he tells him he's got cancer to get him out of this. He could give two shits. He says, didn't you get the arrangement I sent? Here's a guy that's supposed to be his friend, Bacala Sr.
His closest guy, yeah.
You know,
you're June, his closest guy.
That's his father, out of respect, the whole way around. You know, and Bobby winds up apologizing. He apologizes to him. I mean, I remember shooting this scene like it was yesterday. You know, Dominic in that chair, and, you know, Bobby's a little confused. It's, you know, he lost his father. You know, now Junior's got cancer. He may go, you know.
It's a really good scene.
He's a really...
You guys had some good stuff here.
He's a really selfish... Junior is a really selfish... self-centered guy.
How do you feel now? You're Weisenheimer.
Weisenheimer. How do you,
you
feel
aren't
now?
Being a Weisenheimer.
I got cancer. Now how do you feel? Outdoor lawn, the back of the fountains of Wayne. Tony sees the cop. He made a big order, $897.23. He says, make sure it gets to my house in one piece. And he hands him $200. And he doesn't take the money. So he gives him like a big fuck you to Tony Soprano.
He basically, you know, that he's got a moral high ground, he takes a moral high ground more than Tony Soprano does. You know, I don't think Tony even needs this thing that he's buying. I think he's there.
Yeah, I think he just spent the money.
He doesn't even need this friggin' thing.
That's what I would say. Yeah, that's what I would say.
And a great song at the end there that's shucked up by R.L. Burnside. We heard R.L. Burnside's song, It's Bad You Know, in episode, season one, episode 13, the finale, when Silvio and Tony are on the boat after they kill Chucky Signore. That's a great
It's a really, this was a really, really good episode. For me and
a lot. A lot of stuff.
Bobby, the character, I mean, it kind of opened the doors, really introduced him, you know, to the audience. Junior, so good. Listen, I don't
Bert
see...
Young.
It is seamless here. I don't see, you know, Brian Tarantino, Bert Young. I mean...
Johnny V was great.
Great stuff, man. I mean, just really, really good. Jesus. I mean, the show is... It's so good, man. I'm really enjoying just watching it.
Me
know,
too, man. This one,
I really,
this was a joy. This episode,
really enjoying it. You know, it's.
I feel
Bert
the same
Young,
way.
You forget. You know, Bert Young was so good. I wonder if they thought about bringing him back, you know, maybe in a flashback or something, because, you know, they talked about him. You know, way in the last season on the boat, he says your father was the Terminator. You know. Tony tells Bobby, you know, when he asked him if he ever did a hit, he says, no, you know, I never did. He said, well, your father was the Terminator. So he was a big hitman Bacala Senior. Great episode. Great episode.
All right. Now it's time for the Talking Sopranos Ask Me Anything segment. The winner of our AMA Best Question of the Week is Paul from Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania. We're going to send Paul a pair of Bose headphones.
So Paul asks, at the Soprano table reads, did you guys just read your lines or read them like you were doing a scene?
That's a good question.
Yeah, and let's explain. Why don't you explain what a table read is for the people that don't know? I know we've talked about it, but go ahead.
So shortly before we'd start shooting an episode, it would be during a lunch break. It was a day usually that we'd be at Silver Cup Studios. During the lunch break, the actors in that next episode would come into a conference room around a big table. And the actors who were in that episode, maybe they had one line. It's their only episode. They'd be there too. And there'd be lots of food. There'd be a big spread of food, sandwiches and salads and all kinds of pasta and all kinds of stuff. And we'd sit around and we would read the episode. First, you'd introduce yourself. Hi, I'm Michael Imperioli. I play Christopher Moltisanti. You know, everybody would introduce themselves. And we'd read it. I mean... To be honest, the answer to the question is somewhere in between. You wouldn't just read them cold like they didn't mean anything, and you wouldn't really play it full tilt, especially if it was a big, heavy emotional scene, but you would give it juice. So it would be kind of in between. You would give it a little flavor. And the point was, for the writers like to hear how stuff sounded coming out of the actors' mouths, because sometimes after the read-throughs, they would make revisions to the script if they felt like something didn't land, it didn't sound right, you know. For me, they were really fun because a lot of actors I didn't work with, like I didn't ever worked with Lorraine in a scene, so I'd see her at the read-throughs and that would be fun and we'd get to read together. That was one aspect that was fun, and all of us together in the same room was always fun.
Yeah. Even if you had one line, you were invited. So that was kind of a big deal for people. I mean, you know, they got one line and here's the entire cast. Sometimes, depending on the size of the episode, there could be 50 people in there. It was a big square table. It was mandatory. Mandatory, yeah. It was mandatory you had to come. We also would sign a bunch of posters and scripts for charity and memorabilia afterwards. They would have stacks of posters on the table and pilot scripts and pictures and stuff that people, they would give out to charity. I remember I had never been to a read-through before, you know, before this. And I asked. I think I mentioned it on Joe Rogan's show. I asked Joe. I happened to see Joe right before I went, and I asked another comic, Bill Kirkenbauer. I said, do you do this exact question? Do you do it all the way? What happens? And they, you know, they told me about 80%. You know, about 80%, like you say, you don't go all out, but they want to hear the words. And I remember the first one. It was the first one that I did with all the fat jokes. And afterwards, Jim came up to me and introduced himself and said, you're not that much fatter than me. So that's a nice compliment. You're not that much. He said, you're not that much fatter than me. And I said, well, I'm wearing a fat suit. Oh, all right. Now it makes sense. But then I had heard, which I didn't know before afterwards, that people get fired at read-throughs.
If they find that they don't, I guess if you don't, don't do it well, and not at most shows after The Sopranos did not do read-throughs. I'll tell you the truth, especially shows that are doing 22 episodes.
It's impossible.
It's a lot quicker pace. It's impossible. And usually, and very often not necessary, because a lot of shows, The Sopranos was a very, you know, the way it's written. You know, a lot of shows like episodic TV, you know, detective shows, it's about the plot. It's about a lot of exposition. The Sopranos was really about the characters. It's very different. And David would do an announcement. Before we started, he would always tell the people who were new and say, please do not reveal any of this to anybody. reveal any of the storylines to anybody. Yeah. That he would started doing that. I don't know which season, but.
But sitcoms, when you do a sitcom, the first table read is Monday morning. So you're going to do a sitcom, it's usually 4 days or if they go 5 days. Monday morning, they do a table read and the jokes, and it's much smaller and a lot less people, obviously, in a sitcom. But they still do it, you know, I mean, pre-pandemic or, you know, post, whichever. So they do a table read. They want to hear those jokes. They want to hear if they work or not. So you get a lot of that. I tell you a story. There's a comic, she's a female, that I knew for a long time, very funny, and they sold a show with her name. You know, she it was going to be her name. It was going to be the blah, blah, I don't want to embarrass her. The so-and-so show, and it was a slam dunk. I heard this from her manager. Slam dunk, the show was sold. They were doing the read-through. At the read-through, she changed her voice, almost did it with an accent. Suddenly, it was based on her act. Suddenly, what they bought, you know, like the Drew Carey show, Seinfeld, you know, it was that guy, you know. That's not what she did. She did something completely different. They took a break. They had a talk with her. We want you to do just what you sold. What
as you.
Did. Yeah. As you. They even, she was so bad and so nervous and couldn't do it, they were going to hire someone to play her. Swear to God.
And why couldn't she do it?
She just couldn't do it. Some people just can't do it. A lot of comics, not every comic could act. You know, not every
no,
comic could
that's
act.
For sure. Yeah.
It's a different muscle. It's a different thing. And not every act, of course, could do stand-up, which is one of the most difficult art forms there is. But she could not do it. And the show never went. And she continued on with a okay career, club comic mostly. You know, did Tonight shows, but nothing with nothing, you know. And but that's the read-through. I used to go about 80% and pick up things along the way, like Dominic when he had a spit.
Oh, 80%, you mean in effort, in acting.
Effort. You know? Yeah, I mean, if you had a cry, you don't go, ah!
No. You give a flavor to it. You give it some juice.
You know, if you got to yell, you know, Dominic used to spit when he had a spit. He would spit in his hand, you know, not really spit, but, you know, fake it, you know. And then you had some people should have did it a little more because it was defeating the purpose. But I heard numerous people got fired at the read-through. They said, well...
From The Sopranos? On The Sopranos?
No, not on The Sopranos. Just in general.
On different shows.
Yeah,
oh,
different
okay.
shows, you know. So there you have it. We got Paul. Thank you. You'll be getting your Bose headphones. So thank you for that question. Hey, and thanks for listening. Remember, new episodes are released every Monday. So please subscribe to the Talking Sopranos podcast on YouTube, Apple Music, Spotify, Amazon, or wherever you get your podcasts. Follow us on Twitter and Instagram, and like us on Facebook. And right now, you can get official Talking Sopranos merchandise on TalkingSopranos.com or through our YouTube channel.
Our executive producer is Jeff Sussman, producer is Andy Verderam. Our music was composed and performed by Elijah Amatin. You can hear more of Elijah's music and the band Zopa, which Elijah and I play in together, by clicking the links on TalkingSopranos.com. Our fantastic production crew includes Eric Desi, Bobby Hutch, Frank McKay, Ty Verderam, and Sierra Schirripa. Talking Sopranos is a Pod Jams production.
All right, my friend. I'll see you, pal. Take care of yourself.